Blackstone Publishing presents A Silent Fury, The El Bordo Mine Fire, by Yuri Herrera, translated by Lisa Dillman. This book is read by Armando Durán. El Bordo. The El Bordo mine, located in the mining district of Pachuca Real del Monte, had 10 levels, each named for its depth in meters underground. 142, 207, 255, 305, 365, 392, 415, 445, 465, and 525. These could be reached via three different shafts, El Bordo, La Luz, and Sacramento, the latter belonging to the Santa Ana mine. The El Bordo caught fire on the morning of March 10, 1920. At least 87 people were killed. Traces of this history are few. The Pachuca 1920-1966 case file, a handful of news stories, and a metal plaque that talks about something else. The file and news stories do not simply convey the events, but are fragments of the events. They are part of the tragedy and the way its official version was imposed. In these texts, there appear both favored men, who were never at risk of being so much as scratched by a prickly question, and men and women who were doomed from the outset. But there are also oral accounts, given by miners and their families, and it was through these that I learned about the fire. There are at least two crónicas, one by Félix Castillo, the other by José Luis Islas, and a novel by Rodolfo Benavides. All were written years afterwards. This book, like those accounts, refuses the judicial truth that reduces this history to a file in an archive. But none of these words are mine. I reconstruct the El Bordo fire using the names, dates, and events that coincide in these accounts, insofar as coincidence is possible. And where the accounts disagree, I use what appears to be most credible. I also call attention to some of the extraordinary contradictions and omissions in sources from that period that contributed to a persistent silence. Silence is not the absence of history. It's a history hidden beneath shapes that must be deciphered. That day, the bells never rang. The ones that were there expressly for that kind of event, even though, as the agent from the public prosecutor's office noted months later, they were indeed functioning properly. There were some who later said that they first smelled smoke at 2 o'clock in the morning, but it was at 6 that Delfino Rendon raised the cry of alarm, once he had finished cleaning the chutes on level 415. He had just extracted several loads of metal on 525 when he detected an unfamiliar smell and decided to go up, and then up some more. And on reaching 365 and approaching the shaft wellhead, he noticed something that smelled like wood smoke and that the level was too hot. He saw no flames of any kind, nor did he need to in order to know that someplace they were already licking the mine shaft, so he raised the cry of alarm, which was more of an act than a cry, because the first thing he did was to send down the cages to get people out and then notify the stations by telephone, telling them to inform everyone to get out now, right now, immediately. That's what he did, as any self-respecting man would have done. Worry about his fellow workers before worrying about machines or stopping to wonder how this could have happened. And the cages went up and down perhaps 8 times, bringing up 10 miners per trip at most. Delfino kept sending down cages, which disappeared into the unbearable clouds of smoke filling the shaft, and those cages came back up, but then they came up empty. Agustin Hernandez, cager, would later say it was at the 7 o'clock whistle that the fire got really fierce. But the first flames could have broken out much earlier, or perhaps they were what caused the smoke he smelled at 4:30 or 5 when he stopped on level 365. Still, when Hernandez asked Antonio Lopez de Nava what was going on, the deputy foreman replied, "Can't you tell? They just blasted, so the air's full of powder dust." And since he convinced himself that it must, of course, have been the blast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.